Shalom Chavrim, I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. This is our broadcast where we go into teachings, and so we trust it'll be a blessing for you this evening. It is the Passover season, so we will be talking about Yeshua and how his life, why he gave his life, and how that is a reflection here of our Passover season. Before I get into that, I do want to state something here to you guys. There are many people, or I shouldn't say many, there is a small group of people that have been making a lot of false accusations about what we stand for and the research that we do here. Keep in mind, Israeli News Live originally is an Institute of Biblical Research. And it's not that I have some degree from a university, but I have spent my life studying God's Word, and as well in more recent years studying different books that are written out there that are either were part of the canon at one time or were removed, even books that were found at Qumran, different books that have been discovered all over the world in different places. And there has been quite a bit of confusion and critics because we have quoted from the Humane Gospel or the Gospel of the Holy Twelve. I do realize there's differing opinions by scholars on those books, as there are on many of the books out there, including the Book of Enoch. There's a lot of debate as to whether they're authentic or whether they've been tampered with, etc. Understand, what me and my wife here do is we research these things and we look for a common thread. It does not mean that we believe everything that is written in one book or the other, including the Humane Gospel. But we have seen a common thread that is in these books as well as in our own canon. It's questions that my own Jewish brethren come up and ask to me. You know, what about this here? In other words, one of the big questions is they say that Torah would be totally against a human sacrifice. So how do you fit Yeshua in being a sacrifice or the Lamb of God? The other issues come up about as far as a virgin birth. They say that it's in Hebrew, and when you deal with Isaiah 7 in the Masoretic text, it actually states it as Alma, a young maiden. But keep in mind, we look at things from an objective standpoint. Even the part about the virgin birth, it seems to suggest in the Humane Gospel that it was not a virgin birth, but it actually seems to suggest it was greater than that, depending on how you were to look at it. But nonetheless, we know from the research we've done, even back then, between the Nazarenes and the Ebionite groups there, which were the Essenes, there was a major debate as to whether or not Yeshua was a virgin-born son of God or not. We don't necessarily take one side or the other in these types of debates because we try to look at things from an objective point of view. We see that Jeremiah and Isaiah both were condemning the sacrifices. We see a common thread in that, even in our own gospel, when Yeshua says, if you knew what this meant, you would not have condemned the innocent with the guilty. Now, a lot of people say this is a direct reference to Yeshua the Messiah, but in the Howard book of Matthew, which is a Hebraic translation that has been authenticated down through time that the Jews always kept in debate of the Christians. They also quote this scripture here, and it says that you would have not have condemned the guiltless, the innocent with the guiltless, and it's written in the Hebraic form showing that it was sacrificial animals and in the plural. So they even took it then that it was speaking of the sacrifices. So what it is we're looking for those common threads in these documents. And also keeping in mind, we ourselves personally have taken on the lifestyle of a vegetarian lifestyle. This is also seen in the early church fathers. Many of them, Tertullian, Clement, even Peter in the homilies, the Clementine homilies, also was vegetarian. And they speak about this in all of these books. The Syriac Gospel also speaks about the vegetarian lifestyle. And so, but we don't say that people that are listening to us that you have to be a vegetarian or a vegan or whatever the case may be. What we see is a common thread historically in some of these documents here as well as in our own canon. We're finding those common threads. And this is what we're trying to do in our research, is to bring to the people those things from an objective point of view. And we're not sitting there siding one way or the other. We don't say that people are lost and going to hell because they don't believe this or they don't believe that. These things are for your own individual purpose. We do, though, however, believe that God Himself, as many ministers would agree today, that God established in the Garden of Eden a vegan diet, from what we can tell by the scripture. They were to, both animals and humans were to eat of all the plants and trees of the seeds that came forth from themselves. That is true. We see that. All right. And we also can see, and we're pretty much everyone is in agreement that yes, in the millennial reign, nothing shall kill nor destroy in all his holy mountain. That's what the Lord says there. Even my wife brought out a good point in one of her videos recently when she talked about how the swords and the bows would all be beaten and they'll be turned to plowshares and sickles instead for harvesting and reaping. She said, notice, all the instruments of war are being done away with. So we see that God had a perfect will in the beginning and restores back his perfect will in the millennium. And in between, that space in between, we're under a permissive will of God. Ezekiel chapter 20, Ezekiel also brings out these very interesting points. And he even shows Ezekiel chapter 20 around verse 25, 26, 27, 28, shows how the children of Israel would not keep his commandments. So therefore, he gave them a law. And when he speaks of this law here, this is where the sacrifices come in. This is what Ezekiel shows us here, how the sacrificial system got started. He permitted it, but it wasn't his perfect will. So we are only examining these things from God's perfect will and not saying that you have to keep this way, but we cannot be stifled in the research. We cannot be threatened by the people out there and these little cliques that are saying you're leading people to hell. How do you lead people to hell? By sharing with them the research that's out there. And yet people present us research. There's only one person in all the people out there that disagreed with me, that actually took the time to come to me. And that brother has never done an evil video about me either. He's not done any kind of evil, wicked things. He came there and we've established a communication where we are both looking at each other's own research. And see, that's the way brothers should do. It shouldn't be that you don't go to your brother in private and speak to him. And if you've emailed me and didn't get an answer, email me again. Okay, because I do answer my emails. I get behind many, many times because, as you guys know, we get 100 to 200 emails a day. It's very hard to keep up with that many emails, and I'm sure you would know yourself. But if you've got a difference, the right thing as Christians to do is you come to the brother. If you've got a difference with them, come to them privately and try to reason this out. Many times, you can go back through all these videos, nearly 1,000 videos now. There's been many times I've come forward and said, so-and-so wrote me, they give me this information here, I reasoned that out, wrote them back even and told them, I said, you know what, you're right, I stand corrected. Went online right here on YouTube and I said, you know, so-and-so wrote me and they presented this evidence here and I do see that I need to stand corrected on that issue there, and I corrected those things. That has happened through time because I'm not anybody. I'm just your brother. You know, I'm not one of the witnesses either. I've done many videos about the two witnesses, but contrary to where some people think these things, I am not one of the two witnesses. I'm just your brother. I do feel that God has called me to try to help my own people to recognize that Yeshua is the Messiah. But I believe that that is part of the biblical thing that will happen. The two witnesses will come, by the way, and when they do come, they're coming because why? There's no religion that seems to have it correct. That's obvious. Why? Because what do the two witnesses do when they do come? The two witnesses are coming because there's so many scruples to begin with. If there was one denomination or the other, or if Christianity as a whole had it all right, which, by the way, they're all going back to Mother Rome there at the Catholic Church, they're all joining right back into Mother Rome. So if the Vatican had these things right, God would not have to say he's sending two witnesses, would he? He could just say, I'm sending two Roman priests down there, or two evangelicals, or two messianic believers down there to Israel to reveal to them that I am the Mashiach. And then they would be killed. Well, if they really truly believed the way the Vatican does, or whatever group there is out there, they would never be killed, would they? So it's very obvious that the two witnesses are definitely not going to be part of any of the mainstream theologies or ideas. No wonder why the scripture says that 10 people of the nations will take a hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew and say, show us your ways. We hear that God is with you. Okay, this is, I believe, a very good insight of what the two witnesses are. The Gentiles, the people of the nations, wanting to know what they have to say. But I am not one of those. And regardless of what the lies that are going out there are perpetrated, you know what we stand for. Now, later this weekend or earlier this week, we're going to also present some of these evidences here from our research. And by the way, some of these books that people are saying, oh, it was done by demons or whatever, there are document examiners. Document examiners that have been part of the research on the Dead Sea Scrolls that say otherwise. This is why I can't just take one side or the other. You have to remember, the Catholic Church is big in rewriting history and using scholars to debunk a lot of issues. There's even Catholic scholars that try to debunk King David's tomb being there at Mount Zion. But there's also a lot of scholars that say otherwise. So I do realize there's both sides of the equations. And if you do disagree with me, have the decency to just come to me yourself, privately. You have my email, stephenbenoon@aol.com, or just email from any of the websites. That goes directly to my email. So I would get your email. Sometimes they fall into spam, and I don't check spam very often, but when I do try to go. Today I did spam, and I was able to answer several people that had written me there. You know, but for the most case, those people that are against me never bother to email me. They just go out there and spread a bunch of hate videos instead, claiming that they have the right answer. Well, I don't claim that I have all the right answers, but I do try, and it's a freedom of speech in the United States of America, and I am a U.S. citizen with the right of free speech. But I'll tell you, I've even been threatened. I was threatened by one man, and I won't call his name, because I've loved the brother very much, but I was threatened that if I did not Skype him on a regular basis weekly, that he would go out and expose me. Expose me for what? Well, he went out there and lied, that's for sure. But that's the shame right there. And I was even threatened again recently. I am to stay with the canon and not research any book outside that. Does that not sound like to you the inquisitor spirit that the Catholic Church had on it and that they were taking and burning people at the stake that did not agree with them? Even Martin Luther, friends. Martin Luther, he did do some good things, but Martin Luther also went out there and wanted to kill all of the Jews. That is a spirit of God? No, it's not. We're going to be looking at a lot of things here in the very near future, along with our news broadcast that we're trying to bring you. And by the way, it's another issue about some of these books as well. Again, we can't say that everything in these books are accurate, but especially even prophetic things that are there that have obviously, because the books have been written 2,000 or more years ago in some cases, there are prophetic tones laying in there. Even in the book of Esther, I want to go back to that. It used to be in the King James Bible. Why'd they take it out? You might be surprised to find out why they took it out. But anyway, again, I couldn't say the whole book is right, but it does have some prophecies in there dealing with today, just like Enoch does or any of these books. Very clear prophecies that deal with today. These are the common threads that I find. I find it even in the canon that we have, and that's what I try to match up. That's what my wife tries to match up. Same thing, even like where Paul goes in here and writes all these things, supposedly. Now, we got to keep in mind, did Paul really write all these things? I don't know, but let's say this here. He said many things about women that just seems like hatred towards women. You never see Yeshua ever have that type of hatred towards women. But when you go in to look at the translation, you find out it's mistranslated. See, that's the type of things we try to look at. All right. So anyway, God bless you. Let's move right into this. Why Yeshua gave his life. There are many people that say, well, Steve, you're against sacrifices. Then how then can you believe then that the lamb, that Yeshua was the Lamb of God and that it was a type? Sure, I believe it's a type. Sure, I believe that he was the Lamb of God. Why? That lamb was an innocent creature, never sinned, never did nothing, did not deserve to die. But they killed him anyway. The same thing with Yeshua. He didn't deserve to die, He was true. He was clean. He was pure. He was a true Nazarite from his mother's womb, but yet he was murdered anyway, right? Now, he does say, I gave my life freely. And two, even in that humane gospel, that's something I can agree with. Yeshua does say, he says, I will give my life. I will give my life's blood for you. So yes, that blood means something to us. And that's what we're going to look at tonight. Why he gave his life, what he did it for, and how it brings about redemption. All right, that's what's important. He brought redemption, friends. And this is where our research goes. Let's take a look here. Exodus chapter 17, verse 6 here. We have right here, Hineni omod lefnecha sham al-chatzur bechorev vehakit betzur veyotzu mimenu mayim. See, what is it? The water coming out of the rock, from the rock, the water. See, what is he doing? God has told Moses to go and smite the rock. All right, now watch what he says here though. Veshuta ha'am, see, and the people will drink. Ve'yasukin Moshe la'eni Zakani Yisrael. See, he's to do this in the sight of the elders of Israel. But watch what it says. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock. Al-Hatsua. God is on the rock. See, didn't even Paul say that Yeshua was that rock? Think about that, friends. All right. Now, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it. See? Amazing. Behakit betzur. He'll strike the rock and the water will come out of the rock. And there shall come water out of the rock and that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Now, let's take a look at what was going on before this happened. And the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness. This is Exodus 17, verse 1. The wilderness of sin, and their journeys according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim. And there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore, the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do you tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do unto this people that they almost are ready to stone me? And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people and take with thee of the elders of Israel and thy rod wherewith thou smotest the river, and take in thine hand and go. Now, you wonder why Moses smote the river? Remember what happened when he smote the river? It turns to blood. That river represented the waters of life. And when that river would be stricken, and Yeshua is the river, the water of life, and when Yeshua would be stricken, that blood would come out. All right? Keep that in mind. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it. Mimenu mayim. All right? And that the people may drink, and Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Now remember, we're going to go into this in just a minute. I don't want to jump too far ahead, but remember, Yeshua was stricken. And the Bible record tells us that both blood and water come from his side. All right, just hold that thought there. I don't want to jump ahead too quick there. Let's look at Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Then the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. That last part of the verse there, Ipak bepa'av nishmar chayim ve'yahi ha'adam lenefesh chayah. All right, and he breathed into his nostrils. See, the be'af or be'apav. We pronounce it with a P sound there, but af is the nose. In this case here in the biblical text, it's apav. See, he breathed in his nose. Nishmat chayim. See, and he literally breathes in that breath of life right into him. Why do you think Yeshua, after his resurrection, comes and breathes upon his apostles and says, receive ye the Holy Ghost? It should be the Holy Spirit. But that's okay. Receive ye the Holy Spirit. Yeshua does that. Why did he do that? He was the same God in Genesis that breathed in that clay figure laying on the ground, the life of Almighty God. Because where do you think the word chai comes from? Chai is life. It is God's own life. That's why there's a yod in that word right there. It represents his life. But notice that chayim is the life in a plural form coming out of the mouth, the breath of Almighty God, going into this ha'adam, this humankind, this form that was made from the adama, the earth, the dust of the earth, right? So God breathes into him. Now it says lenefesh chaya, which means he himself becomes an independent life. But inside of him is a multiple life, a plural form life. Why? Because Eve, Isha, is inside of him. And she is filled with the Holy Spirit as well. Even like John, notice how the scripture says that John, from his mother's womb, was filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? Because he is a type of Isha. He's a type of the bride of Adam. In this case here, John was a type of the bride of Mashiach. So therefore, as even God had put the Holy Spirit in Eve, inside of Adam, so God put the Holy Spirit in John while he was yet in his own mother's womb. And that happened when the name Yeshua was spoken into the ears of his mother. Blessed be the Lord. All right? So that's what happens. Let's take a look at this a little deeper. Genesis 2:23. This is how we know. And the man said, this is now bone of my bones. What? God has taken out Eve now from his side. He puts him into that deep sleep. Notice Yeshua was put into a deep sleep, wasn't he? Do you know the word there in Hebrew when he talks about that deep sleep? You know, when he talks about that in Hebrew, that's the same word for a coma. That's exactly right. So it's death. He was near to death. Yeshua actually died and his side was opened up just like Adam's side was opened up that brought forth his bride. Yeshua's side was opened up so that his bride could be coming forth. His hands being pierced and his feet being pierced was the way they murdered him. But his side being pierced was what brought forth that eternal life. All right? That's the same thing with Eve. That's where your type is. That's why Zechariah, this is why the research is important, friends. In Zechariah, what do they argue about right there with Rabbi Tovia Singer? And I know Rabbi Tovia Singer. He's asked me, brother, call me. I want to talk to you about why you believe Yeshua the way you do. I've got to know it. I can show you where Rabbi Singer has said that to me. He says, you're not like the other Christians. He said, I can defeat them easily, but I want to talk to you personally. All right, now what does it say though? What does it say right there that it says in there, and I've actually got the scripture laying here, so I'll get to it in a second as well, but he says that we have in King James that he was pierced, but it's actually true translated, it's thrust through. And Rabbi Singer brings that out. He says it doesn't say that he was pierced, it says that the one in Zechariah was thrust through. Sure, he was thrust through with the spear by the Romans on his side. And what was it for? Just like it was with Adam. It was to bring forth life. All right? Now, watch what he says. Now, you don't get this good in English either, but let me just share it. And the man said, this is the now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. It doesn't say in Hebrew she was taken out of man. Ha'adom. It doesn't say nothing about, you know, taken from the man, lakacha. See, it doesn't say that. It says that she was taken from me'ish. Now, ish is also another word for man, but Adam is normally used for the word man in Hebrew. But watch what it says here in Hebrew. Lazot ikara isha, see? And the man says, you know, he's saying that this here is now bone. It really goes into a lot of words that are not even there in Hebrew, all right? See? My apology. I forgot I only put part of the verse down here. That's my apology. I'm too far ahead of myself. Lizot ikara, all right? And this, he calls Isha. He calls her Isha. It's actually only part of the verse. My apology. Isha. Ki me'ish. See, from ish lakacha zot. She is taken. She was taken. All right. Now the ish is a little different. And I want to show you that. Here's what on your screen that you can see here. On the right-hand side, Aleph Yod Shin, Ish. On the left side, Aleph Shin He, Isha. This is what they're actually called. Now the rabbis will even show you. Notice what the letters in white, Aleph Shin, that is the word Eish for fire. All right? The little letters in yellow, Yod He, which I put also at the top there, is Yah. It is God Himself. And even in the teaching by the rabbinate there, they say that it is Yah in the life of a husband and wife. And if you take out Yah out of there, you have nothing but a consuming fire. It's not a consuming fire. That Eish inside of there with the Yod in there represents, it's the Spirit of God within that man and in that woman. That's what it represents. It was God's own life. And notice, in order to have the fullness of God, you have to have the man and the woman together, see, that represent Him. Why? Because God is both our Father and Mother. He's only one God, though. Don't get that wrong. He's not like two out there. It's one God, but He is both Father and Mother to us. All right? And so therefore, in the man and the woman, it types God. See, and there's many analogies that God uses. What did Yeshua said? You know, He says, how often, Israel, I would have gathered you as a hen would her own brood. He types Himself as a mother chicken. He said, but you would not. See, Yeshua types Himself as mother and father. And that's why a man and a woman together express who God really is. And it takes them together for the Spirit of God to work. All right, now let's look at this. If we examine the letters of the Hebrew word of mayim, we see the mem means from, okay, and the yod for Yah. Now I'm bringing this up because notice in Moses' case, God said to him, go and smite the rock that it bring forth its waters. Is that right? Go and smite that rock that it bring forth its waters. And that rock was Yeshua. He was Christ, the anointed one. All right. And what comes out? The water comes out. Remember, too, like I said, Moses smote the river because God says, take that same staff that you got and go smite the river that it turns to blood. That was a foreshadowing of the coming of the Messiah as well, that when His side would be stabbed, that water and blood both would proceed from that side. All right. And it would also show that it would take the rivers of water to come from the rock. It would take, in other words, in Moses smiting the rock in order to bring forth the life of Almighty God that had been forfeited from the fall of the Garden of Eden, it would take the smiting of the rock to restore back that life of God to the people of today. This is why He died. This is why He gave His life willingly, because Yeshua knew that inside of Him, like it was with Adam, Adam at one time had both Ish and Isha in Him, and in Yeshua was both portions of the Holy Spirit. In other words, the Chaim was already in Him. The Holy Spirit for both man and women was in Yeshua right there when He was walking the earth. But the only way that that could truly come upon them was for Him to lay His life down, allow His blood to pour out so that His life could separate and come back upon us. Why do you think He says to Peter, after you are converted, strengthen your brethren? What do you mean converted? He wasn't converted yet? No, He wasn't. They were all still scared until the Holy Spirit could come upon them. Wow. So the Mayim also reflects that. Why? Because the Mem is the representation. Every time, if we use from something, you normally just have the Mem in there. The word mean, Mem Nun, is the word for mean. Mean, which means in English, from. All right? So, but if you're just going to use it as a compound word there, from we used it just a minute ago, mimenu, all right, that was from something, only the mem represents the word mean in that case there. So here, the mem, again, represents from, the yod represents Yah, so from Yah in the mem as the plural. In other words, this water that's coming from the rock literally represented that the life of Almighty God would come from the rock. That's what water represents. It represents the waters of life, and that the only way to bring forth that water was to strike that rock, and it would take, then you have to drink it in order to receive it. This is why Yeshua did the communion the way he did it. Wow. And by the way, friends, it's a lot deeper than you have any idea about. Much deeper. Communion is daily, friends. Partaking of the fruit of the vine and eating the bread is a daily thing. Every day you do that, you are doing what he said. Do this in remembrance of me. Wow, this is it's amazing to me. All right, let's go on. I want to look at some more things that prove this. Watch what happened. Yeshua comes at the well there. It's a little bit long to read this. We've got two frames to look at this, okay? About 26 verses, or about 20 verses. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Yeshua saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away to the city to buy meat. Actually, the word is bread. It's not meat, okay? So, or food, ochel. But in Greek, it's actually, it's either bread or food. I forget which one. That's just an old term used by the King's English there. In fact, I think out of the 60-something times, it's only the majority, like 50-something times, refers to just regular food. All right. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which a woman of Samaria, for the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. See, there was so much prejudice back then. Oh, gosh. And by the way, let me tell you something. Look at the History Channel. They did a documentary about the Qumran community. All the scholars in there said it was an Essene community. Why? They've got Josephus, they got Pliny, the early church father, that said, Pliny actually identifies where the Essene community or Ebonite community was, and that was on the northwest corner of the Dead Sea between Engedi and Jericho. Qumran's the only place that's between those two places on the northwest corner, and it was discovered there. And they don't want, but see, now the Vatican is trying to say no. They're trying to use their scholars to say, no, this was not an Essene community. This was on the Zadokites. This was the Zadokite priesthood that was there. Yeah, they were. Now, I don't say that Yeshua was an Essene. Don't make mistake that I say that. I don't know. I can't by my own research prove that yes or no. All right? I don't know for sure on that part there. But I do know one thing. He was not a Pharisee. That is a lie straight out of the Catholic dogma. And I don't go for dogmas. All right? But and another reason why the Catholic Church doesn't want you to know that it was a truly Essene community is because one of their 5th century bishops of the Catholic Church stated that there was the Essene community that lived there at the time of Israel, and that they claimed that they had writings of Moses that were not, they claimed to have the same writings that the priest had of Moses, but they also said that there were other books of Moses that they had themselves that the priest, the Hasmoneans, did not agree with. Now keep in mind, the Hasmoneans were not the true Levites. That's historical facts. What happened? One of the Maccabee brothers exalted himself to the priesthood, and he was not a Levite. And the true Levites were thrown out. That's what actually happened. That's why the Zadokite priest actually goes down to Qumran and set up down there. All right? But the Catholic bishop, 5th century Catholic bishop, I wasn't planning on speaking about this, right? I had it up here for you. I can bring it out next time. I'll try to bring it out the next day or so. But he actually stated that it was the Essenes that had that. Now, so the Vatican has had to been trying to backtrack. Even though all these scholars said on the History Channel it's an Essene community, they're backtracking, trying to change that and get scholars to rebut that. Why? Because supposedly this Essene community, according to their bishop, has books that they don't know about. So they have to make it look like that this is not the Essene community. Otherwise, what is the people going to do? Where are those books then? Your own bishop says they were there. Where are they? You know what? They will never let it out. We should make a demand that the Vatican release all the true evidence that was found at Qumran. But you know what? They will not let it out. I've got friends in Israel that can verify this as a fact. Good friends that know that the Vatican is hiding this fact and will not let these books out from the Dead Sea Scrolls. And they have their scholars running around saying, no, oh, Yeshua was never mentioned in any of the books that we found there. That's a lie. That is a lie. You just don't want to admit it. Oh my gosh. Let's continue on right here. The woman said, art thou greater than our, back up to verse 10. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him and he would give thee living water. He's testifying that he's that rock that Moses smote. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence are you going to get this living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Yeshua answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Yeshua saith unto her, go call your husband and come hither. And the woman, we know, she answers, she doesn't have a husband. And then he goes on to say, I say unto you, you've had five husbands, and the one you're living with now is not your husband. And she says, oh my gosh. And she runs into the city, drops her water pot, says, come see a man that ever told me everything I'd ever do. Now, what was Yeshua doing, though, when he spoke to the woman at the well? He was giving her a sign to look for. Indirectly, he gave her a sign. He says, I would give you water that you don't have to come here for. Now, she doesn't ask for that water, or no, I think she does. I think she says, give me this water that I don't have to come here. See, but he couldn't give it until he laid his life down. You understand? That water, Yeshua knew the water represented Yahweh. It represents the life of Almighty God. Yahweh is not the right way to say this, okay? Anyway, other things, just quickly to share with this with you as well. Notice the types in the Bible. Eliezer, who goes to get the beautiful wife for Isaac, Rebekah, for he's the servant of Abraham. See, what does he do? He says, you know, why does she draw the water? It's a beautiful type here. Why does she draw the water? Why is that water being drawn? He asks God for a sign. Watch what it says here. Genesis 24:43. Behold, I stand by the well of water, and it shall come to pass, he's praying to God, that when the virgin cometh forth to draw water, and I say to her, give me, I pray thee, a little water of thy pitcher to drink. And she say to me, both drink thou, and I will also draw for thy camels. Let the same be the woman whom the Lord hath appointed out for my master's son. And before I had done speaking in mine heart, behold, Rebekah came forth with her pitcher on her shoulder, and she went down into the well and drew water. And I said unto her, let me drink, I pray thee. And she gives water to him and to the camels and everything. Now, why is it here that Rebekah is the one drawing the water and giving the water? Because it shows that through the woman, that seed, that life of water would come down through a woman. Remember, even in the scripture where it says that the man is, you know, just trying to show that there was no hierarchy, because even though the woman come from the man, so the man shall come from the woman. Remember that scripture? I think it's in Corinthians or someplace like that. Do you know that speaking of the coming of Yeshua? It's talking about the divine birth of Yeshua, that he would come through the woman. Genesis 3:15, watch what it says. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The woman has a seed. Why? Because when God breathed in there, he breathed into there that eternal seed of word, that life was breathed in there. And that descendants was brought down. And so Rebekah drawing the water, showing that through that woman there would come that promised son. And by the way, do you know, listen. The Bible says that Adam sinned willfully. Is that right? Yes, he did. But remember, Eve, it was in ignorance. She didn't do anything intentionally. Adam did intentionally. So Yeshua has to lay down his life because of the intentional sin of Adam. But do you know, in reality, it was Mary that corrected the mistake of Eve. All Eve ever did was doubted God's word. She disbelieved it. She questioned it. Not Mary. She believed it unconditionally. And by believing it unconditionally, the seed of life was able to come out through her. So Yeshua was assigned to Israel. We find in John chapter 19, verse 33, but when they came to Yeshua and saw that he was dead already, they break not his legs. And we know the scripture said not a bone of him would be broken. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he saw that it was and bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that you might believe. See? That, now watch what happens. Look at Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. See? It's beautiful right here. And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and upon and of supplication, and they shall look unto me because they have thrust him through, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. All right. Now, notice what it says right there. Let me back up to that one little spot. See? And upon the inhabitants of the Spirit of Grace, and they shall look unto me because they have thrust him through. Now, in King James, they translate that pierced. But dakar, the Hebrew word right there in yellow for you on your screen, dakar u, see? That's for him, the U right there, the Vav at the end with the Dagish there. That represents him. But Dakad, literally in Hebrew, it means to stab. See? Piercing, well, you would pierce the nail through the hand as well. But in this case here, what is Zechariah really talking about? Zechariah was showing the true redemption was not that they put the nails in his hands or his feet. Although they did do that, we know that. But Zechariah was talking about that he would be thrust through. That's where the redemption would come from. Why? Because when the blood and the water could flow out of his side, that then the life was in the blood. And the spirit that was in him could come out so that it could come back upon the believers. This is what brings true redemption for both Jew and Gentile. This is what the Jews of today are waiting upon, is the restoring of the Spirit of Almighty God upon their own lives. And this is why he is that Lamb of God. We're about ready to close, friends. Exodus 17, 6. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of all the elders of Israel. Friends, we have to drink. We have to drink the waters of life as he breathed upon his apostles and said, receive ye the Holy Spirit. Yeshua is that innocent Lamb of God that was killed. But he allowed them to take his life because he knew without it, that life that was in him. See, notice, Adam was the same way. Adam willingly laid down as God put him into that deep sleep so that his bride could come forth. What was his bride? She was the anointed of God inside of him. Amazing story. Amazing story. Friends, we love you dearly. We really do love you. If you stand with us and believe these things, we thank you for that. Whether it be your prayers, whether it be you stand with us financially and prayers, whichever it may be, we thank you for it. There's a lot of people that don't like what we're saying. And I do believe there's a major Catholic conspiracy. It's where it started. It's come against us. I've been threatened by a lot of people. But because I don't heed the threats, now they're trying a new routine. If you've been involved in any of that, you know, please, no, I love you. You know, I hate to see anybody get caught up in that. But do know, I love you. I love even those people that are against me because I trust and pray that God will help them to understand. I'm not their enemy. I'm not there to try to lead someone astray or anything like that. But I want to share what God lays on my heart. Everyone has their own individual walk with the Lord. The Bible says, search out your own salvation with trembling and fear. It also says, prove all things. How do you prove the Bible is real to a Jewish people that don't want to accept a Roman version of it unless you can take the documentation that they know is true and show that, yes, there is truth here as well. This is what we're doing. You can visit our website. We will be publishing on our website, IsraelReturns.com. We will publish a rebuttal towards some of those evils that are going on out there, and also a clarification, just like I've made here today, a clarification of what our true stand is so that people do not misunderstand us or take things out of context, what we're trying to bring. And from this point on, I'll bring things here right on Israeli News Live during the weekend when we're not focused on the news. Of course, if there's something on the news that's important that we need to bring out, we'll get that out to you as quickly as possible. Can't cover everything, but we will try to bring those things out. And if there's something that relates to prophecy, we'll try to share that with you, at least our opinion on it. Doesn't mean that we're right on this all the time. We're just, like you, prayerfully seeking and considering those things that may very well be prophetic in nature. I'm Stephen Benoon with Israeli News Live, Benoon Institute of Biblical Research. Shalom and God bless you.